Driver fatigue causes an estimated 100,000 police-reported crashes every year, resulting in more than 1,500 deaths, thousands of injuries, and monetary losses in the billions. Chronic sleep problems are known to contribute to depression, hypertension, coronary artery disease, and stroke. And they can certainly affect our personal relationships. More than 50 million Americans suffer from some type of sleep disorder. With training in the Polysomnography program at Montgomery College, you can help them.
It wasn't until about 1953 that REM was even recognized, that REM sleep occurred. That's when it was first described and understood. So, you know, we're talking about just about 60 years in which we've gone from just the basics of understanding a little bit about sleep to recognizing about 80 different sleep disorders at this point.
As you are about to learn, sleep medicine has evolved into a medical specialty all its own. Sleep disorders vary, but for most, diagnosis starts at a sleep study center.
Most common things we see, for example, in the sleep center at Georgetown, and in most diagnostic sleep centers, for example, are obstructive sleep apnea, which is a disorder when patients, when they go into deeper stages of sleep, they lose muscular control in their upper airway, which causes an obstruction in the airway, and they actually stop breathing during their sleep. With apnea, their oxygen saturations begin to drop, and their heart rate increases, and causes them to wake up frequently throughout the night, which leads them to be very sleepy on the next day.
Patients who have restless leg syndrome have discomfort in their legs, particularly when they're lying down in the evening. And most commonly, they will have to get up and take a walk will relieve their discomfort, and then they'll try and get back to sleep. So the sleep does get interrupted. Another well-known sleep disorder is something called narcolepsy. The patients with narcolepsy have severe sleepiness. They'll suddenly have sleep attacks. That's sort of the characteristic thing. So I must tell you that anybody who is severely sleep deprived can have these sudden sleep attacks.
Narcolepsy might also include sudden muscle weakness and hallucinations or vivid dreams. Other common sleep disorders include insomnia, in which patients complain of trouble falling asleep or trouble staying asleep during the night, and a subset of disorders called parasomnias. These include sleepwalking episodes, acting out one's dreams, and other unusual behavior while sleeping. The symptoms of most sleep disorders are what you might expect to see in a person who isn't getting enough sleep, despite the fact that they claim to sleep as many as 8 to 10 hours a night. Symptoms like fatigue, sleepiness, and trouble concentrating are to blame for thousands of traffic and industrial accidents every year.
The amount and the cost to society of this is in the hundreds of billions of dollars. It's just amazing. We would estimate maybe hundreds of thousands of motor vehicle accidents per year in this country are related to being sleepy at the wheel.
The National Transportation Safety Board, which is located here in DC, you know, investigates traffic accidents regularly, whether on the road or in the air. There have been some airline pilots, for example, who have fallen asleep while flying passengers. There was a flight going to one of the islands in Hawaii and actually overshot the island because both the pilot and the co-pilot had fallen asleep. So these issues are getting a lot of attention.
There's no question that your efficiency is less if you're significantly sleep deprived. And there are some studies of recurrently sleep depriving somebody over a period of a few weeks, let's say, so that they only have 6 hours of sleep, can't do any catch-up sleep, and testing them. And some of the tests is very similar to being intoxicated or having a significant amount of alcohol in your system. So the difference is that you're not necessarily aware that you're not functioning on all cylinders.
Unfortunately, the not-so-obvious effects of sleep disorders are just as dangerous. Many patients suffer from high blood pressure, heart problems, stroke, and depression. Proper diagnosis and treatment are essential to improving the lives of those who suffer from sleep disorders and the safety of those around them. In polysomnography, sleep studies are performed to assess and diagnose these disorders. The trained professionals who perform the studies are known as polysomnographic technologists. These technologists assist in the clinical assessment, physiological testing, diagnosis, management, and prevention of sleep-related disorders. As a team, physicians, sleep specialists, and technologists work with patients to identify symptoms and then, if necessary, schedule a polysomnogram. This study is usually conducted overnight in a sleep center. During a sleep study, the technologist uses multiple diagnostic tests to track sleep cycles.
We monitor a patient's electrical brain activity, brain waves during the night, and we have different channels that are scrolling throughout the night with their brain waves. We monitor their respiratory activity or their breathing throughout the night, muscle activity, heart rate, a lot of these different variables that give us a good picture of what's happening during sleep at night.
This requires a series of sensors that are placed on the patient's head, face, and chest. Sensors glued to the scalp monitor the brain's activity.
There are sensors that are glued or pasted near the eyes that will monitor the movement of the eyes, and that information is also important in finding what stages of sleep a person is in.
Electrodes placed at the collarbone and on the chest measure heart rate and rhythm. Sensors placed on the leg and chin monitor muscle movement during sleep.
There'll be a sensor that is in front of the nose and the mouth, or in the nose and has a little thing that goes into the mouth also. It monitors the air coming in and out of the mouth and then the nose. That's one of the respiratory measures that we use. Usually we'll have two belts, one on the chest and one on the abdomen, that also monitors the movement of the chest and abdomen. It helps us understand about the breathing.
There'll be an oxygen sensor placed on your fingertips so we can monitor your oxygen level throughout the night. Also, there'll be a little microphone tape near your throat, which will monitor for the snoring.
And video cameras are sometimes used to monitor patient movement during the study.
The data that we obtain from the sleep study is really extensive. An average sleep study may be 800 to 1,000 pages of information. And if we have, 10 or 15 different channels of data from all of the different leads and signals that we place during the study, we've got 800 pages of each of those. So during the day, a technologist will actually go through and analyze all of the different data that we've obtained during the sleep study. And they will compile statistics from how the patient was breathing, how steadily they slept during the night, how often did they wake up, did they have neurological arousals regularly due to breathing disorders, anything like that. We'll compile a report of statistics that the physician will then interpret as well. So it's pretty labor intensive to score and report on a sleep study. All of that happens after the patient leaves. And then once that report is completed, it will be sent back to the ordering doctor and they'll move forward with treating the patient.
Well, we have a technologist who is almost alone with the patient. During the course of the night, that technologist has to make significant decisions with some patients who could be very sick, whose breathing might stop 60 times, 70 times an hour. That's more than once a minute. And they have to decide how to treat that patient. So we want people who are well-trained, and we think we need a uniform training, we need an adequate training program, so that we know that when a polysomnography student has gone through the training and they're going to be going into the work field, that we're comfortable with having them taken care of such sick patients. So I think we need to have good training programs, and I think the program that we've set up is an excellent training program that sort of really lays the groundwork.
For technologists to come into the job market with formal education in sleep technology gives them a leg up.
They start to lose deeper sleep first.
The polysomnography program at Montgomery College began in the fall of 2009 with our first group of students.
The program currently consists of courses that deal with sleep medicine technology. These include anatomy and physiology, psychology, computer applications, and others. Students get hands-on lab practice and participate in clinical rotations at hospitals and sleep centers in the DC metro area.
during those rotations there, working alongside experienced sleep technologists and getting some real hands-on experience with patients. And during that course of those clinical hours, they're actually getting to the point where they're becoming competent themselves and actually performing the studies themselves under the supervision of those technologists.
Basically, what I do is hooking up the patient, and they just tell you, okay, do the hookup, and we are watching you. If you do something wrong, we help you. And that, you know, kind of giving, encouraging you in order to do by yourself everything, so in order to get experience. And so far, they have done their best of my knowledge, and I have no problem with them. I learn a lot, and I did hook up many times by myself.
Interaction with the patients is, that's what I have to do first time, because you have to make them comfortable.
Patient care is important. You know, patient care comes first. Like anything, my particular clinical site here is the VA, and what we do is we work with a lot of veterans, and so we get a lot of interesting cases. Lots of interesting cases.
Well, I like that our instructors have been in the field for a very long time. Some of them have almost 20 years experience. So the little things and the questions that we have, they always know how to troubleshoot for us.
Anytime I have questions, and I just call them or email them or approach them in person, one-to-one, so far, I had no problem at all.
I think choosing Montgomery College was a valuable choice. I'm the type of person who learns better from teachers explaining rather than just learning it from a computer. So the fact that the teachers give us a hands-on experience, they can answer questions for us, they actually care about what we're doing in the lab.
Is a career in polysomnographic technology right for you?
Someone who works in sleep medicine would need to at least be prepared, if not for their entire career, at least for a period of their career, be prepared to work at nights doing acquisition studies with patients.
You have to be self-motivated.
Have a way to make the patients comfortable in an unfamiliar environment with unfamiliar circumstances and unfamiliar people. You're coming in and sleeping in a place with wires on your head and someone's watching you, but you know, it's not an uncommon thing for the best technologists that I know to get, reports back from their patients saying, I wouldn't have even known I was in a hospital and that sort of thing. So you need someone who, enjoys being around people and is good at developing a rapport with people and really wants to help the patients that they serve.
Once students successfully graduate from the program, they are eligible to sit for the RPSGT, or Registered Polysomnographic Technologist exam, which is presented by the BRPT, or Board of Registered Polysomnographic Technologists. This credential is the gold standard in the field of sleep medicine technology credentials.
Each exam is computerized. You get immediate feedback upon completion to let you know whether or not you passed or failed. The credential is good for 5 years. You have to maintain a minimum of 10 continuing education credits each year to maintain your credential. This is a field that a person should consider. You can definitely sustain a good livelihood. I've been a sleep tech for over 20-something years. I've been able to help my kids go through college. As a result of being a sleep tech, there's good money to be made in the field. It's a good field to work for, especially if you like helping people. And one of the biggest benefits of being a sleep tech is you actually get to see immediate results.
A new graduate could start work probably almost immediately after graduation. Clinical students will have much exposure to working in the lab, so the jobs are out there. The salary range varies pretty significantly based on geography. I would say in the DC area, we have a good one of the higher salary ranges nationally.
Sleep technologists in the Maryland and Washington DC area can make as much as $25 to $30 or more per hour upon graduation.
It's also, a field where we've got good job security. There's a lot of jobs out there. I'm looking to hire several technologists myself right now, so it's got a lot of job security and a lot of opportunity for advancement for technologists.
There's over 50 million people that have sleep apnea that's undiagnosed. So there's a lot of patients out there. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. So if a person was looking for some type of career field or looking for longevity in a career field, being a sleep technologist is definitely a good field to consider.
Recognizing the importance of these illnesses, the cost to society of sleep problems, and recognition that we really need to attend to this is all sort of coming together at the same point. So I think that sort of makes it clear that we really need people to enter the field. We really need more capacity to diagnose people, to treat people.
Sleep technology is very rewarding for the technologist performing the study for the patients. We get to see on the short term a positive outcome for our patients. We get to see them wake up oftentimes the next morning feeling refreshed, and they may say, this is the first time I've felt this well. This is the first good night's sleep I've had in many years.
If you are interested in learning more about the polysomnography program at Montgomery College, please visit us on the web at montgomerycollege.edu and search for polysomnography.